Thank you, Margaret. Well, good morning and welcome everybody on this lovely frosty morning. It was the slight surprise as I walked out to go down to St. John's that, oh, I've got to de-ice the car before I can set off, haven't I? But we made it, we got there. And people at St. John's all send their best wishes to you. Welcome to everybody who's here this morning. We're going to start off with that great hymn, Christ Triumphant Ever Reigning, this being Christ the King. So. Jesus Christ is King,
and he shall reign forever.
Please be seated. We join together in our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. We say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver us from all sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And the collect for today, Christ the King. Eternal Father, whose Son, Jesus Christ, ascended to the throne of heaven that he might rule over all things as Lord and King, keep the Church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at his feet, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see you. And yes, the church is slowly warming up there. I'm slowly each week turning on the heating just that little bit earlier. Don't tell the treasurer. But obviously it's also getting colder as we do that and try and work out and find just that sweet spot there. So there are blankets at the back if you need those just to feel warm enough. This week, all the normal things are happening, but next weekend is our start into Advent and Christmas and all the things that will be exciting as we do that. So next weekend, there's a lot happening. It sounds almost mundane to say we've got a coffee morning and we've got the grounds work teams out on Saturday morning, because then we also have starting our Christmas tree festival. A big thank you to all involved in that. And on Sunday afternoon will be our Christingle. So that's going to be 4 o'clock on Sunday, the Christingle service. And if anybody wants to come and help to put together the Christingles, then this Friday at 9:30, Margaret Toft would be really pleased if you can come and help build Christingles here, assuming you have an idea what Christingles are and what they represent. So that will be, how many do we need to build, Margaret?
In the vestry.
In the vestry, all the orange. In the vestry, so we're gonna go in the vestry and make that nice and warm.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. How many are we doing? 100 oranges made into Christingles, ready for the service. And it should be perhaps one of the best Christingle services ever, because we're gonna have the Christmas trees lit, and then we obviously there's that point in the service where we light the Christingles and sing, and hopefully will be something that will stick in the memory of children and help to convey to them something of the message of Christmas. Then we run through every week there is something. So next week is Christingle, the week after, the second week of Advent, we have the Churches Together service at 4 o'clock in the afternoon at the Methodist Church. The week after that, the third Sunday of Advent, we have our carols by candlelight at 6:30 here in the church. Again, another beautiful service and scene. The week after that, the fourth Sunday of Advent, is also Christmas Eve. And so we will have our 4 o'clock crib service. Then at St. John's there'll be a 6:30 carol service, and then a midnight communion here starting at 11:15, and then on Christmas morning our 11 o'clock service with a communion afterwards that will be family orientated for families to come along to. And so just lots of stuff that's happening over the next few weeks. Please invite others. There is a list of all those services in the back, so you don't need to worry about that. And is there anything else I've forgotten in all that? Oh yes, so today we have a baptism. Today the name of the child is Leo Ezra Duffy. We did his sister a few years ago, and now we get the matching set today. So do write a little prayer for Leo, and then we will have the joy after this service of doing the baptism.
Thank you, Stuart. Just a quickie around the Christmas tree festival. Thank you to everybody who's offered cakes. We look like we've got a good selection there. We have really no idea how many people are going to come to this, but I think we've got a good range there. There are still a few gaps on people willing to be in church and serve refreshments across the weekend, particularly our Sunday afternoon between sort of 2 o'clock and 4 o'clock, which is the lead up to the Christingle service. So if anybody hasn't signed up and feels that they're able to offer some help, we probably need sort of 3 or 4 people at each time slot, I would think that would do. That would be lovely. Thank you very much. So we'll move on with our service, and can we have our first reading from the Bible?
First reading this morning is from Ezekiel, reading chapter 34, verses 11 to 16, and then verses 20 to 24. For this is what the Sovereign Lord says: I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. As a shepherd looks after his scattered flock when he is with them, so I will look after my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a day of clouds and darkness. I will bring them out from the nations and gather them from the countries, and I will bring them into their own land. I will pasture them on the mountains of Israel, in the ravines and in all the settlements in the land. I will tend them in a good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel will be their grazing land. There they will lie down in good grazing land, and there they will feed in a rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will tend my sheep and have them lie down, declares the Sovereign Lord. I will search for the lost and bring back the strays. I will bind up the injured and strengthen the weak, but the sleek and the strong I will destroy. I will shepherd the flock with justice. Therefore, this is what the Sovereign Lord says to them: See, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. Because you shove with flank and shoulder, butting all the weak sheep with your horns until you have driven them away. I will save my flock, and they will no longer be plundered. I will judge between one sheep and another. I will place over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will tend them. He will tend them and be their shepherd. I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David will be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And now our next song is actually on video, and it's entitled He Shall Reign Forevermore.
Creation grows for a world in darkness.
Please remain standing for our gospel reading.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. It's Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. The sheep and the goats. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you are blessed by my Father. Take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needed clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" The king will reply, "I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me." Then he will say to those on his left, "Depart from me. You are cursed into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me." They also will answer, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you?" He will reply, "I tell you the truth. Whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me." Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you, Lynn.
Father God, as we think on Christ, his rule and reign, his purpose, speak to us today. Send your spirit that you might birth in our hearts that fruit which you wish us to bear in our lives. Amen. Please sit. I must say, it's honestly positively warm in here compared to where it was in St. John's. I've slowly been warming up. As I've got here, and it's great to see you all here today, and we're going to in particular just think a bit about the mission statement. For those of you that don't know, one of the things that the PCC tasked me with was taking what had effectively, for the most part, been a strapline of Share Christ with Others — there was a little bit more on the website — and developing that as a mission statement for the church. And so we're going to be reflecting on that, but I'm going to hop off from the gospel readings, hooking in the Ezekiel reading for you to start off. So over the last 3 weeks, we've been in Matthew 25, and that has three parables, and each of these parables has two sides to the story. You have the wise versus the foolish in the story of the bridesmaids and not being ready. Then you have the good servant against the bad servants in the parable of the talents and how people use what God has given you. And then today we have the sheep and the goats. And perhaps you don't see quite how that fits into the pattern, but if you just think about the Ezekiel passage, in the Ezekiel passage, it actually does, in the bit that's missing out in that passage, mention rams and goats as part of God has created a flock of his people, and they are not serving their purpose because they're supposed to be a flock, and a flock is supposed to work together and defend itself. That, have you ever been stampeded by a herd of cows? It is positively scary, as if they feel threatened, they move towards you. I've actually also had the same done to me by sheep, and they're not much better. We also walked once in Chatsworth, and this mother sheep was there, and she was trying to drum up some support off the others. As Maria was walking towards her, stamping her foot, as Maria's going, "Oh, lamb!" And she's going, "Keep away." And they're supposed to work together. But the problem in Ezekiel is that you've got, can I just change the metaphor, fat cats. You've got fat sheep. And they are stealing and butting out the weak ones. And rather than working as a herd, there's some who are serving their own purpose and not meeting the needs of others. And actually, as you start to translate that into Matthew 25 and see that those who Jesus goes, "Come in, you're being good sheep, come on, come in, enjoy everything I have for you," were the ones who are actually meeting the needs of those who were needy and vulnerable in society. And so it is sort of there, this pattern of these parallels. What is it to do it right? What is it to do it wrong? And none of these, I don't think, are intended in their primary purpose to be how we are saved. They are supposed to be parables that are speaking to a group of people that see themselves as being involved in God's purpose, involved in God's mission, and how you fulfill the mission and whether you do it well or poorly. What does it mean? And he's speaking it in particular to those who will choose in response to this, and just look a few verses on into chapter 26, verse 3, they decide that they're going to get rid of Jesus, to those who should have been the wise, the good servants, the sheep, and were actually acting like the fools, the bad servants, and the goats, and they decide that they're going to kill Jesus for this and get rid of him in some way. And this is one of those key moments, therefore, in Matthew's gospel. But as we think about this as the mission of God, invited to be involved in the mission, then what is that mission? And the use of the word mission is actually slightly different than business would use mission statement. The business has taken it from the church. The church originally took it from kingdoms. And it's probably that the church is closer to the original sense of the meaning. If we can take the slides on too. Because in the business sense, we say, what's the mission of the business? Whereas actually, in the original sense, the missio, those who were sent, or apostello in the Greek, because the missio is Latin, both of them had that same sense of those who were sent by somebody in authority, probably usually a king in the normal way of thinking at it, representing the king's interests. Ambassador might be a sense of it. And in that sense, it's not the church's mission that we are in and we decide what our mission is. It's God's mission. And God has, go back a second, because we will just go through it. We will move back one more. God has a mission, and that is to save humanity and the whole of creation. God made everything for himself. He made something to enjoy, to love, to be involved with. He gave us free will so that we could choose to have a personal relationship with him. That was our purpose. And yet it got broken and damaged. And you only need to look at the way that's told for us in the opening to Genesis to see the brokenness that comes into that. And carrying on to work through the Old Testament sense of the story, then we'll re-loop round for the New Testament. God decides that he is going to have a mission to save all that, to bring it back into a right relationship, to restore the balance to everything, to unite heaven and earth back together and bring it all in there. And that this mission has a church. In the Old Testament sense, this, when I'm talking about church here, I'm talking about people. In the Old Testament sense, he had chose Abraham and Abraham's sons and their sons and the 12 tribes and these people to be at the heart of carrying out God's mission in the world, so that in the end the whole of creation would be saved and it would be a blessing to all the world. And probably in that sort of sense of everything being blessed, Paul's Romans chapter 8 is one of the great chapters for taking that. And as this people formed, they found that it was useful for them to have a focal point, a tent, to meet with God, and then a temple, and then they didn't have a temple, then they did have a temple, and as they sort of went through the temple being destroyed and rebuilt, and synagogues and buildings to help them fulfill the mission. If we take it on to the next slide. So God has a mission, the mission has a church, that is people, and the church has some buildings. And we take it on to the next slide, and that's there summarised at the top. One of the difficulties we've got into, and this is the last 50, 60 years worth of missiological thinking about the mission of God, is that during Christendom, where everything seemed to be there, it got a little bit confused. And generally they thought God has a church that has a stipend that appoints a person going there and perhaps a community around them. And then there's a few people that go off to do mission, because the mission's already done in Britain. Everybody's already saved. It's all good. We're all there. But that's not the biblical pattern. Because if you think about it, in the biblical pattern, God has a mission to save all people. Jesus, the King, becomes the baby on the stable. That's the last song that we sung. And so that he can take our part and heal all the wounds by dying for us and being born back and being bursting out of the tomb back into life, so that he can form a people that are the people of God who are united by the Spirit of God being with them, so that they are united, God and the people, to slowly transform the whole of creation and bring all humanity back to God and to help them in that purpose. The early church didn't have any buildings. They borrowed the temple from the Jewish faith. And then when they were kicked out of the temple, they used houses. And then when they were persecuted, they used catacombs and the places where you would bury the dead underneath the city to meet. And then eventually, as Rome became Christian, they would take over the Roman temples and then we would have churches, because of the sense of place. And if you think about this, it starts to make a lot of sense. Because if you start off with this one, and you bombed this building, well, that wouldn't destroy everything that comes afterwards. There'd still be people and there'd still be mission. But actually, it means it's on the first one working way back. If you bomb the buildings, you still have people, you still have mission. God is still working through, and eventually we would get other buildings, because one of the truths of mission is that when a church hasn't got buildings, they long to have a building. When they have got a building, they rue how much it costs to keep the building. But if the mission fails, if the church fails to pass on to the next generation of people their vocation of being the church of God, then the buildings become museums, as we're seeing all too often, and as may happen, or redundant buildings, as may happen with St. John's. So God is the God, it's God's mission we're on, not the church's mission. He has a mission that people get involved with, and we might have buildings that help us in that process, we might not, but it starts off with God's mission to the whole of the world, which we participate in. And that's the big difference between modern business thinking on mission, where it's the organization's mission. No, we are on God's mission, doing God's purpose. And if you look at the back of church, you will find the mission statement printed out around where all of the, and take it on to the next one, around where all of the information is about the tower. And the front page is really a lot around God and what we understand about God and God's purpose in the world, and getting to understand that. And so how do we participate in it? Well, I broke this down into this, but if you take it onto the next side, we can summarize it as this, that we perhaps have five things to do as our participation in the mission of God. And the mission, Missio Dei, is the way that theologians term it. And first of all, is to experience. That before we start anything else, actually we experience God. For those of you that know the Westminster Catechism, you'll know that the first of the questions is about what is our primary purpose. And our primary purpose is to worship, give worth to God. That draws from this story I've been telling you about God having a mission to everybody. He created us for himself to know and to love him. And that's our primary purpose. And when he tried to explain this in the Old Testament, he would say in the Ten Commandments, I'm the Lord your God, you shall have no other gods but me. I'm the one that you shall love and worship. Or in the Shema, that the Lord your God is one, you shall love the Lord your God with all your whole heart, soul, and with all your strength. And Jesus would pick that up in the New Testament when asked, what is the greatest commandment? And he says, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength is the greatest commandment. The second is love your neighbor as yourself. Our first calling is to know and to love God, to experience God, to meet him, to heal the wounds and the division that sin has brought between man and humanity, and between humanity and humanity, as we see all too often around the world, and between humanity and creation, which we were called to be stewards of and care for, which all three directions, that those relationships are broken, and our starting point is heal our relationship with God, which Jesus does for us in what he has done for us in dying and raising from the dead, and invites us back into a relationship, an experience of God, a living faith. And the second two, you might say, are the same, but there's a key difference I want to get between them, to witness and to share. To share Jesus with others was our strapline, our way of summarizing it, because if we share Jesus, then with Jesus comes the Father and the Spirit. That's just always the case. You look at how Jesus talks, you look at how the Gospels are shaped and how his preaching is shaped. He always points to the Father, he always points to the Spirit. That's part of the fullness and the Trinity, or the Godhead of God. But the witness is about us and who we are and our intent. You won't all be Billy Grahams. You won't all be Rob Frosts or whichever missionary you wish to talk about, who perhaps you might have a few other names you want to add into that. But when the widow came with her offering, Jesus said that God doesn't look at the outside, he looks at the heart. What's our intent? And our intent matters. You've all come across that sort of like really dysfunctional thing in teenagers, I'm assuming, where somebody starts going out with somebody and they're all shy about it and they won't tell anybody. And it's really rather dysfunctional. And you love to rib them about it because it is dysfunctional. Well, in the same way, if we're in a relationship with God, but it's only 1 hour on Sunday, it's a dysfunctional relationship. And if they find out at work or wherever, they'll probably rib you about it. They'll probably rib you if they know that you are a Christian, but that's for a whole different load of reasons, and that gets into the Beatitudes, and that's another sermon for another day. But if they realise that you are hiding it, you're only a Sunday, 1 hour a day, 1 hour Sunday once a week, 1 hour, one day Christian, they will rib you for it. Dietrich Bonhoeffer put it like this, and this is a loose translation, when hopefully after Easter we're looking at it, whoo, we've gone. When after Easter we're looking at it, we will put up the quote in a better translation, but he said something like this. You should live your Christian life in such a way that your atheist friends doubt their disbelief in God. Have a think of that one. You should live your life, you should own your relationship with God in such a way that others who don't believe in God go, have I got it wrong? Ooh, is there a better way to live? And there's something about being a witness. And that witness can be, and probably one of our sermon series will be around when the disciples go. The disciples believed, but some doubted. We may not have it all sorted out. But we are still called to be witnesses to what we've experienced of God. And what we know of God, what we find in Jesus, that's what we're called to witness to. Our experience of God, not somebody else's experience of God, not how somebody else puts it in a book about how you should share your faith, but what you've experienced of God, what you're excited about Jesus, what you love and you think, look at Jesus, go, oh, he's just such an amazing role model for my life. That's what you witness to. And you witness to what you've experienced. And in so doing, you share with others. And that's about connecting what you've witnessed to them. Now, that's part of communication. You know, if you've got, because you've got your hearing aids, is that sometimes what people say and what you hear is completely different. Because our brains try to work it all out. And the same that happens always in communication is, I don't know what I've said till I know what somebody else has heard or how they've misheard me. And actually, Rob had a chat with me afterwards, and he'd misheard something of what I'd said to you in saying this, roughly the same sermon to them. And hopefully I've made it a little bit clearer, because I've already gone through that point. And hopefully nobody will be coming to me going, did you say this? And I went, no, I didn't say this, I said that. And getting it clearer. But the share is about, how do I convey this to somebody else? How does the way that I live my Christian life, how does the way I do my worship, how does the way we do our corporate worship and acts of witness convey the message to somebody else about our faith? And often the church has had to make big leaps in this. If you think about it, when Paul started off as Saul, the Jewish rabbi, coming to Christ, he kept his Jewish name. He stayed in that area where probably they, for the most part, spoke Aramaic. And then slowly God led him out. And as he did, he had to change to his Greek name. He already had the Greek name. And change the language that they were communicating Jesus in to a different language. And he had to change the culture in which they conveyed their message, such that they left aside circumcision, Aramaic, and a whole load of other things, because they failed to translate the Jesus into a new culture, into a new expression that spoke to people. And the same has happened as that gospel has been translated first into Latin and then into numerous other languages, so that almost every language has the gospel in its own language. But also, as we've bridged across into different cultures, when they were trying to share about Jesus being the Lamb of God, Eskimos had no idea what a lamb was, so they used seal pup to explain it, as they conveyed the message of Jesus to other people. And we've just gone through, or are still going through, one of the biggest cultural changes possibly ever, that, amongst other things, massively increases our amount of choice. Let me put this in real terms to you. When I had my first daughter 29 years ago, I just got my first desktop computer. And on that desktop computer, we could have a disc that we put in called Reader Rabbit, which was the first game that she could play. Nicholas and Maria have tablets that they can download games for themselves off the internet onto. And we are running round now, trying to stay one step ahead of all the encryption and etc., to make sure that they have safe choices to download, because there are people who are trying to make them unsafe. This week, Maria was complaining that we wouldn't let her do certain things to do with roadblocks. Roadblocks is a kid's game. It's very blocky. You build things, you do things with it. And she was convinced of some of the advertising that she'd come across on kids' YouTube that she could enter a code and she could get free Robux, which is the money that you get in Roblox. And we showed her on the Roblox website where it says, there is no passcodes to get free money. There's no this. They're trying to collect your data. She would not believe us that it was a scam. And we're having to teach 8-9-year-olds about scams that we're getting every day. We get telephone calls wanting us to give our bank details. I'm getting texts that want me to give out personal details. I'm getting emails that want me to give out personal details and buy Viagra and other drugs and personal time with a personal masseuse and all sorts of other things off the internet. And our culture has massively changed as we've gone onto the internet. And I can see it in the difference between my 29-year-old and what she experienced playing Reader Rabbit, where she had one program to play, and where my kids have access to just the whole of the internet if we're not careful to box off into safe zones what they do. And that means one of the key changes that we've had is we've got massively more choice than we ever had. Have you ever gone into the supermarket to buy a card and stood there for half an hour in absolute frozen with choice overload? One of the things that I think we can share into our society is that we therefore need role models that we can trust who help us to negotiate the world. And Christianity has a role model in Christ that can help us to negotiate the world. And I think, as we do find that Christianity refines its tread after this massive culture change, I think that that sort of sense of wisdom against fool, which was part of that first parable, found in that Christ as a role model offers us wisdom on how to make good choices, is actually one of the things that will speak into our society in coming years and help people to negotiate the world. That in Christ is a role model who shows us how to live life well. And this is all around relationship. God's relationship with us and with the whole of his creation that he wants to restore. So part of our role into that is to build connections. We already do this. We build connections together. It's why sharing tea and coffee afterwards, or if we do them at any services where we do the tea and coffee before, that gathering stuff is all really important. Because it's about healing brokenness and division that's part of the message. It's why it's really important that Bishop William was with us last week, sharing about Boga and one of our mission partners in the ABC link. It's why really important. It's why we go to Oasis and why we use the sort of resources from CPAS and from CSW to connect into the wider church, but also to build connections into our community. Loneliness has been at epidemic proportions, if you take the research, for the last 20 or 30 years. And people need to build connection. And it's through those connections that we share the mission of God. We share God's love and salvation to others. And in all that, we look to build the kingdom of God. And where we can't build the whole kingdom of God, we look to support and build kingdom values, those things that echo and resonate with us, where we can support them anywhere in our community to try and build God's mission in the world. Because it's God that has a mission to save the whole of creation. And yes, it may at times be that we think the church has failed. We may think if St. John's Church closed that that's a failure. Let me tell you about the church in China. When Thomas was alive, Paul started heading west towards Rome. Thomas started heading east towards India. And he's reputed to have started the Martuma Church in India. That church carried on the mission and planted all the way into China. That church died. But when the missionaries got there in recent years and planted a church, that church has grown. And even though the church once died in China, it is now growing strongly and one of the brilliant stories of God's mission. Because even if this expression or that expression fails, God will not fail in his mission. That's one of the promises we have in Scripture. And the invite to the people of God is to join in that and to be part of it, to be the wise ones, to be the good servants using our talents well, to be those who are the sheep and get invited into everything God has, because we're fulfilling the purpose of being the herd that God calls us to be. And we are not therefore here for the mission of the church, we're here for the mission of God as God's representatives, for joining in what God is doing. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that your mission doesn't fail. It may ebb and flow with tides, but in the long run, your church has continued to grow. Your purpose of winning back for yourself all that you've made, so it may be in a loving relationship with you, goes on until heaven and earth is united and you embrace all. And Lord, we pray that you will help us to fulfill our parts in your mission and to use our buildings in ways that help to support your mission, so that in all things people get to know you and your love, the love that you have shown in Christ, who was born in the stable, lived amongst us, died for us, burst from the tomb, and now has taken his place of rule and reign at the throne at your right-hand side. Lord, equip us to fulfill our part of your mission. Amen.
Let us stand and confirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken by the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please sit or kneel for our prayers.
in the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith. Lord, we give you thanks for our Saviour, Jesus Christ, on this Sunday when we celebrate Christ the King. We also think of our prayers and preparations that we may be in readiness for Christ coming on earth again as we look forward to Advent next week. Jesus, our King, we praise you for all that you have done for us. We thank you for your willingness to accept victory on a cross, for taking upon yourself the sins of the world and bringing salvation to the world. As we celebrate your kingship, forgive us that we are so often weak in your sight. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Strengthen your bishops, Mark, Sam, and Julie in this diocese, and all your church in the service of Christ, that those who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, we pray for all those who work to support the work of your church throughout the world. We pray that it will flourish and grow, always in a way that is pleasing to you. We pray for this church, for Stuart, his family, and his whole ministry team, as we ask in our prayers that you will give strength to us all gathered here in our work to proclaim your word throughout this parish. Lord, we especially pray for all those here working with young families, that they may grow in their faith and become a keystone of your church here in Disley. We especially pray today for Leo, Ezra, and his family on the day of his baptism. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless and guide Charles, our King. Give wisdom to all in authority and direct this and every nation in the ways of justice and of peace, that we may honour one another and seek the common good. We condemn all acts of violence, particularly those targeting innocent civilians, men, women and children, who are killed or held hostage while simply trying to live. We ask that leaders are guided to seek a way forward that ends all the violence and war, but finds a way to build peace among peoples and nations, that they may live in unity with their neighbours, that their humanity may be respected, and that they may live without fear. We especially pray for the people of Ukraine. For the people of Israel, for the Palestinian people and all those in Gaza, we give you thanks for the release of hostages, and we pray that the fragile ceasefire in Gaza may continue. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give grace to us, our families and friends, and to all our neighbours, that we may serve Christ in one another and love as he loves us. O Lord, we pray for this community and for our friends and families, that we may grow together in awareness of your love, that our lives together may reflect your brightness and your goodness. May those in distress or who are experiencing troubles in their lives, know that as they go through times of suffering, that you are with them and that you hear their prayer. Help us to behave as sheep rather than goats in our treatment of and our attitudes towards our fellow men, women, and children, in providing help and care as we are able. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. In a few moments of personal prayer, we bring before God those known to us who suffer and are in need at this time. Lord, through our lives and by our prayers, your kingdom has come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all those who have died in the faith of Christ, that they may rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but eternal life. We pray for those we no longer see, but whose memory we treasure. May the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace and rise in glory. Merciful Father, in our hearts we bring to you those previously known to us who have died, but continue to feature in our thoughts and in our prayers. We think today of Harry Thompson, and we pray that Diana knows your comfort. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Faithful God, we give thanks to you for all that you do in our lives. As our church year comes to an end, we commend to you all those for whom we have prayed throughout the year. And we ask that our prayers continue to make a difference in their lives. Rejoicing in the fellowship of Mary, John, and all your saints, we commend ourselves and the whole of creation to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Jeff. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share in his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Let's share the peace.
As you head back towards your places, as I was thinking through for the next song, I thought of a song that I haven't done for a while. It's actually 50 years old this year, but it does link that sense of Christ's rule and reign also with our mission, our calling to go out into the world. And so it seemed fitting. So our offer to him is Alleluia, Alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Lord God, you have a mission, a purpose to draw all people and all things back to yourself for however far off they had wandered. And we give you these gifts of money and our lives to serve that purpose. Amen. As we come to our communion, I'm going to use the special opening that's used for Christ the King just after we've done the initial responses. Just follow it through as we go. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For with the oil of gladness you have anointed Christ the Lord, your only Son, to be our High Priest and King of all creation. As priest, he offered himself once for all upon the cross and redeemed the human race by this perfect sacrifice of peace. As King, he claims dominion over all your creatures, that he may bring back before you infinite majesty, that he may bring before your infinite majesty a kingdom of truth and life, a kingdom of holiness and grace, a kingdom of justice, love and peace. And so, with angels and all the heavenly hosts, we proclaim your glory and are forever praising you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, heavenly Lord, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom. And with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. Please sit or kneel. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Amen. As you come to receive, all are welcome to come who wish and yearn for more of Christ in their lives. Come, for all is ready. Stir up, O Lord, the wills of your faithful people, that they, plenteously bringing forth the fruit of good works, may by you be plenteously rewarded through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Please don't forget to leave your prayer for Leo as we have the baptism afterwards. To maybe stay for a cup of tea and coffee, and also in particular this weekend to start to pray for Advent, for those that will come, for the Christmas tree festival, for the care that we'll do for the grounds, for the coffee morning, and in particular perhaps for the Christingle service when we'll have a lot of young families here connecting with them next Sunday afternoon. But on Christ the King, we finish by praising the King. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Christ is King and rules and reigns on high, and he sends out his ambassadors, and that is you, as his apostello, his missio, his ones who are sent to fulfill his mission in the world. Christ our King, make you faithful and strong to do his will, that you may reign with him in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. And do you now realise the importance of that little sending at the end of the service? Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Hopefully you do, otherwise my sermon completely failed.